found a lump and you were you went for a diagnosis and you received a diagnosis that it was cancerous.
And it wasn't good.
And it wasn't a great diagnosis. It wasn't a good time to be all disrupted.
Right.
And I think that we weren't Christians, so we were both operating sort of under our own control, at least as far as we knew.
If God had taken away my cancer right then, the next part of the story wouldn't have happened, because there was one point after my surgery when he had taken the kids for a walk and I was just by myself, and I can't explain it any more than I just knew that God was God and Jesus was his son. And it caused me to cry, because I realized as a mother now what it must feel like if your children come to you and say, I don't believe you're my mother. And so I had told that to my father all these years. And if people's prayers to take away my cancer had been answered, I wouldn't have reached that point of my life.
So we were at home one night, and I went out on the back porch, and I was upset, and I thought I'd give God a call. I thought I would talk to him for a moment, even though I wasn't sure he was there or that he was listening, but I thought maybe he would make a deal with me. And I started to ask him, you know, what I would have to do to get him to cure her. That was what I was going to ask. And I didn't even get that far, because I realized somewhere in my memory I remembered that he didn't like deals. And so I rephrased my statement to him, just tell me what to do. How about that? That's not a deal. And this voice just came in, it seemed like through my ears, it seemed an audible voice, said, teach your children about me. And I was suddenly kind of aware that my little bit in this world might not be the big picture, and that was strange.
Our children became Christians because of this. I got to know him, and I got to learn what he wanted, and what he wanted was my life. He wanted my love for him to pour out as an offering to him. And so now I serve him.
But then you got cancer again.
Oh yeah, there's that. So I got cancer again. Instead of being upset and terrified like I had the first time I found out it was cancer, my question immediately was, well, God, what are you gonna do with it this time? When I first got cancer as a non-Christian, I was terrified, because my children would not have a mother. And they'd have you, but...
That's terrifying.
That's not. But this time when I got cancer, I didn't even worry about the kids, because I realized that they were God's. They weren't really just ours, that he would take care of them, just like he always had before. I was giving him credit for all of that.
Mm-hmm.
If you've ever seen a tapestry or embroidery, and you look at the back of it, it's just a bunch of knots and string. You can't see, but if you turn it over, it's something beautiful. All I had to do was get cancer, and my children got salvation. This is a very small price to pay. This is something to be joyful about. And he didn't do it just for you or for me. He did it for our children and for the work he had planned in advance for us to do.
And for them.
And for them.
What they'll do.
And for what they'll do.
Yeah, it's a plan.
He's such a big God.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, my wife Liz and I have had the privilege of getting to know David and Kim over the last 3 to 4 years as we've been in different growth groups with them. And you will never find a couple that walks with more humility through the things that they've been through. And at every turn, they just look to God and ask, what would you have us do with this? It's just an amazing story. If you have a chance to come across them, they have just such an amazing story to tell. So this is the second in our series on promises. And the scripture is full of all kinds of promises. The commercial world is very good at taking these promises and kind of condensing them down into just a little quick blurb that you can fit on a coffee mug, or you can fit on a doormat or something. It must be so exciting as a Christian to walk into a gift shop because you get to do your shopping and Bible study all at the same time, right? I mean, it's so efficient. I mean, how could you not come home from a shopping trip like that being so refreshed and reassured with your salvation and everything that God's going to do for you? Scripture's coming at you from every quarter, from coffee cups, welcome mats, posters, aprons, plates, frisbees for crying out loud, keychains, golf balls, everything you can print on. My peace I give you. Ask and you will receive. For I know the plans I have for you, plans to prosper you. If you're not yet a Christian, how could you come out of a gift shop after being bombarded with these kinds of amazing messages, not convinced that you absolutely need Jesus in your life, right? If nothing else, just to be able to coast through the rest of your life, the rest of your existence here on earth, without a care in the world. It should be so absolutely clear, once you give in to God, all the turmoil and struggle of life will be left behind, right? Today we're going to explore one of my favorite verses that we find on various commercial merchandise, and we don't have to go very far in Scripture to find it. It's in Exodus 14:14. In fact, I've got my t-shirt here. I picked up like a good consumer. The Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still. I looked around for some various options that I could get this in. And when you look on the internet, you can find all kinds of stuff. You can have all kinds of different fonts. You can find ones on a beach setting. You can find ones with the mountaintops in the background. Anything you want. They'll put this background behind it. They'll put this on anything that you want to put it on. Some of my favorites. You can imagine this fight that God's engaged in all kinds of different ways. Battle axes. Right? All right. For those of you that are into the medieval warrior times. For those of you who are boxing fans. They've got those for you as well. The Lord's going to fight for you. All you need to do is be still. When I was much less mature in my Christian walk, I carelessly threw out one of these shortened, trite little verses in a context that was completely different than the context that it was presented in Scripture. And I thought I was such a clever Christian. And there was somebody who had done their studying and they called me on it. Here's what I learned through this embarrassing moment. We cannot get our theological insights from the world of consumer products. If we did, this particular verse would suggest that all we need to do is grab a jumbo chili dog, our 128-ounce keg of Coke, sit back on our lazy boy, and watch God take care of it, no matter what we face. Well, I like t-shirts. And I like this scripture, but I like it in the proper context. So, I went ahead and had a new shirt made up. So now when people see me wearing my shirt, they'll understand exactly what the scripture means. So I hope you brought your opera glasses. I don't have any more slides. The rest of it, I'll just point, and you can read through the rest of the sermon this morning. This is where you start, pull out your bulletin if you have it. If you're a note taker, this is where you can start your journey of taking notes. Our theology should come from the Bible, from God-breathed scripture, not from t-shirts and coffee mugs. When we take things with an incredibly myopic view, and we carve everything else around them away from it, and we just look at it, it changes things so dramatically, and sometimes we don't even notice that because we like the message that it has in front of us. It's so beautiful, it's so pure, it's so easy for us. Let's look at some visual examples of this, just to kind of bring this point home. I've got a couple of pictures up here. What do you think this is? Any guesses? This next slide. It's a sponge. All right, let's pull another one up. That's beautiful. I heard it. Somebody's been here before. Teabag. That'd be great as a stained glass window or something, right? What is this? Soap foam. And the last one. Spaghetti. Do you see how much it distorts the meaning of what it is when we carve the context out away from it and we pick just what we like? That's like lucky dipping, right? Scripture doesn't work that way. So we're going to take some time this morning. We're going to unpack Exodus 14, 14. We're going to step back and we're going to look at the big picture, the context around this. So let's pull the camera back and go back a little ways in Exodus. We're going to start in Exodus 2. Verses 23 through 25. During that long period, the king of Egypt died. The Israelites groaned in their slavery and cried out, and their cry for help because of their slavery went up to God. God heard their groaning, and he remembered his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. So God looked on the Israelites and was concerned about them. This is a time when the Israelites are being horribly, horribly oppressed. This is after the time of Joseph. If you remember, Joseph came into Egypt as an Israelite, and he rose through the ranks because of the wisdom that he had that was given to him by God. He pulled the Egyptians through terrible famines with the wisdom of storing up things to save for future years and controlling what went out, and he was highly esteemed in Egypt. And other Israelites came into Egypt, and more Israelites came into Egypt, and generations went on, and now we're a few generations past Joseph, and we now have a Pharaoh in power who is concerned that they're being overrun by Israelites, just like a ship might be overrun by rats. And so how does Pharaoh deal with this? They bump up the workload, the slavery that they're under. He was so concerned that he put out an edict that every male child of an Israelite that's born be put to death. They cried out in their suffering. They cried out to God. And he listened. God is faithful in his promises. So now we listen in on a conversation that God had a little bit later with Moses in Exodus 3, verse 7. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I've heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I'm concerned about their suffering. So I've come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey. The home of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I've seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now, go, I'm sending you, Moses, to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. This is God, faithful in his promises to Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. God responded with a man and a plan. Just as God responded in the story of Esther with a woman and a plan to bring the Israelites out of persecution. Just like he acts in so many other stories we read in Scripture, stories of Ruth and Mary and Paul. This is how God works. He has the power to make all this go away, but he doesn't choose to do that. He chooses to work through us, through his people. He prepares them, and then he puts them to work. He's already crafted the master plan, and yet even Moses grumbled against this plan. If you recall the conversation, Moses pushing back, but Lord, really me, I can barely speak, and you're going to put me in front of all these people and to the Pharaoh himself to speak for you, God Almighty, on your behalf. He's grumbling against this plan that God's prepared him for. So God says, fine, take Aaron with you. He'll be your mouthpiece. And here's a staff, and he showed him all kinds of neat things that God would do with this staff to convince people this is the power of God speaking through Aaron and Moses. He chooses to use us to work. About a year and a half ago, Shoreline entered into a two-year period of raising additional funding for additional, it's a generosity campaign called CALLED. One of the key components of that was this Organic Outreach International ministry that was started up last January. And as I sat in, as they were talking about what they were going to do with the generosity that came in through this initiative, as I was sitting there listening to them describe what was going to happen with Organic Outreach, God spoke to me in that moment. And I knew that this was something that we had to do. And I'd been involved with Organic Outreach leading up to that. I'd led some breakout sessions in the conferences, mostly, you know, how do you do outreach in the workplace? My family and I moved down here to California from Washington State about 7 years ago. Moved down to take a position with the company here, just two blocks down the street. I was brought down as the vice president of underwriting field operations for a large insurance company. And I was being set up to take over as the president. And things were going very, very well. And we were pleased and we were happy. I'd worked for this all my life through various careers, 9 years in the Navy, preparing me to lead and to manage. And then years in the insurance business, learning the ins and outs and preparing myself for this mantle I was going to take on of running this company. And yet God spoke to me in this moment and said, this is important. I went up to Kevin after this presentation and I said, Kevin, we need to make this happen. He said, I know, I wrote the book. Of course, we're going to make this happen, right? I said, well, I have skills. I've done things that I think I can speak into this, help us make this a success. And he said, great, let's have lunch. Lesson one, do not go to lunch with your pastor. So we went and I had a tough time sleeping. And I would get up in the middle of the night and I'd start a list of things. And I showed up at this lunch with a list front and back, about 30 different items. And half of those he'd thought about and they'd been on his mind for years. And he just didn't have the bandwidth to do them. And the other half he hadn't even thought about yet. And we just talked through this whole strategy over lunch, started talking about, well, what kind of person would we need to lead this thing? And by the time we got to the end of it, Kevin said, well, have you ever played What If? I said, that's an interesting concept. That's hilarious. But let's just kind of craft what this position looks like. So we finished that lunch up and agreed that we would continue this conversation at a later date. More to follow. Let's step back and get the bird's eye view of what's happening with this promise that God's made to the Israelites. God will fight for you. You need only to be still. In Exodus 4, verses 29 through 31, Moses and Aaron brought together all the elders of the Israelites, and Aaron told them everything the Lord had said to Moses. He also performed the signs before the people, and they believed. And when they heard that the Lord was concerned about them and had seen their misery, they bowed down and worshiped him. Let's get this story. They were horribly oppressed. Their children were being killed. They cry out to God. God, remember us. Remember your promises. God hears them. He has a man. He has a plan. He sends Moses to explain to them this plan. I'm here to bring you out of Egypt. And they worshiped him for his faithfulness to his promise. Now, it didn't happen overnight. If you remember the story of the plagues and Pharaoh would get right to the edge of, okay, it's fine, you're going to, nope. Sorry, can't go. They bring another plague on. He's ready to let him go. Nope, can't let you go. This went on and finally got to the point that the Pharaoh said, enough. Go. So Moses gathers the Israelites and they head out of town. And as they're headed in the direction of the Red Sea, Pharaoh sits down and his head clears and he says, wait a minute. I just let go. We've got all these projects that are half done, and we just let almost our entire workforce go. What was I thinking? Right? So, reading on in Exodus 14, verses 10 through 12, as the Pharaoh approached, the Israelites looked up, and there were the Egyptians marching after them. They were terrified and they cried out to the Lord. They said to Moses, was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you brought us to the desert to die? What have you done to us by bringing us out of Egypt? Didn't we say to you in Egypt, leave us alone, let us serve the Egyptians? It would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the desert. The Israelites are whining. He removed them from all their slavery and oppression, from their children being killed, just as he had promised them, that they worshiped him for his faithfulness to his promise, that he said he's going to bring them out, and he does this, and he brings them out, and they're whining. Are you even kidding me? Our human nature is to stay in the moment. Our human nature is to say, what have you done for me lately? We miss the bigger picture. We miss the long-range plans that God has for us and for our lives. So in the midst of their whining, Moses says to them, Exodus 14:14, the Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still. Now, other Bible translations of this verse have it worded a little bit differently. In the King James Version, we read, you shall hold your peace. And in the English Standard Version, it says, you only have to be silent. These translations indicate that the verse has nothing to do with holding your ground or sitting back in your lazy boy with your hot dog and your jumbo soda and watching the fight. It says, be still in your heart. Be peaceful in your heart. Be silent. Basically, Moses was telling them, do not be paranoid and groveling and crying and groaning out. Stand firm, but remain calm. Let the peace of the Lord come over you. The next verse, spoken by God, gets right to the point. And this is a verse you're not going to find on a t-shirt. The Lord says, why are you crying out to me? Tell the Israelites to move on. I have a plan for them. I'm leading them to the land of milk and honey. I'm leading them to the promised land. It's a journey. It's not a day trip. I've got your back. I have promised. I am faithful in my promises. I've delivered up to now. I will deliver up to the end. But I want you to participate. I want to work through you. Get up and move. God has a plan for us, but he wants us to participate in that plan. For the Israelites, God had an endpoint in mind, the promised land. That was his will for them. What's God's plan for you? Are you praying for his will in the midst of whatever you're going through, whether it's with a relationship, whether it's with a situation at work, situation with your children, with your neighbors? Are you praying for his will in that? Or are you complaining to him, fight for me. I'll be still. I'll sit here and watch. Are you asking him what his will is for you in this moment? David and Kim did not sit back when she got cancer the second time. Their response was to ask, what would you have us do with this? What will you do with our children through this? In complete faith that he has a plan. I'm convinced, in my experiences watching my own life and other people, that our life begins with God here. We're knit in our mother's womb. He knows every hair on our head. He's put us together. And it ends at some point that he has laid out for us. He has some plan and some endpoint for us. It's the in-between stuff that can get messy. It's the journey from there to there. This is where free will comes in, and we have a tendency to sometimes maybe zig and zag across that path until we recognize this isn't working out exactly well, and we turn to God and we ask his will, not mine. What would you have me do when we find ourselves back on that path until the next time that we start to veer? This is life. This is our human nature. But we need to continue to ask him, where is it you would have me go with this? What would you have me do? Whether it's something you're celebrating or something you're suffering, what is his will in this? Second lunch with Kevin. So a lot of strategizing, working through all the logistics, and really getting a good picture of the type of person that would lead this ministry now. And we get to the end of this lunch, and Kevin now has taken what if kind of to the next level. He gets to the end of lunch, he says, okay, Walt, so on a scale of 0 to 100, where are you? I said, well, if I'm honest, I got to say I'm probably a 75 to 80% there. You know, we've been praying about this. We've been thinking through it. How would this work? You know, I said, one of the biggest challenges we have is we live in one of the most expensive places in the country. I have 2 kids yet to put through college. I know this job pays less than a third of what I'm making. I just don't know how that works. We agreed to continue to pray about it and to move on and continue our planning. Are there areas where you're struggling, where you're just expecting God to handle things and you just can't in your own head see how it's gonna work? You just can't make the math work out right. Are you turning to God and asking him, or just trusting in him? God, even if you aren't gonna show me the logistics, the very specific details of how it works, are you gonna, can I have the faith that you're gonna make it work? I was grumbling, I was pushing. I wasn't ready. In your workplace, in your mission field, are you groaning to God? Are you waiting for him to come in and provide the solution and just take care of it? Or are you moving forward and asking him his will and taking steps, trusting that he is going to be fighting along your side? Yes, he's fighting for you, but he's fighting with you. God delights in blessing and protecting his children. As a parent, those of you who have had the blessing of being parents, and those of you, I think all of you have been children, I suspect. So you've been on the other side of this, even if you haven't been a parent. We can get the big picture of how God must feel. I mean, with the Israelites, it's almost like, you know, you've worked with your kids all the way through, you've helped guide them, they've zigged and they've zagged, and you've protected them from things that they had no idea because they're just ready to barrel forward and convinced they could tackle the world, and you protected them, fought alongside them, had to find that fine balance between how much do I let them swerve off the path before I bring them back, before they really hurt themselves, and then you send them off to college. And you ever feel like after you send them off to college, the only time you hear is when they're crying out, Dad, can you put some more money in my bank account? Dad, can you come take care of this issue for me, this problem for me? I know how God must feel when we run down the road with our own perspective of what reality should be, what our future should be, and we only stop to turn and ask him when things start going south. We should be asking him every step of the way. Some of the toughest moments that I've faced emotionally, or when I'm trying to protect my children, knowing what's right for them, but at the same time hurting inside because I know how badly they want to do something. And yet I know it's not the right thing for them, and I have to crush their dream, or I have to crush their desire with as much grace and love as I possibly can, hoping that they'll understand when they get older. I think that's how God feels about us sometimes. God protects us as his children, at least he wants to. So we get to the third lunch, and Kevin's really pressing on me, and I tell him, you know, it is the logistics piece. That's the only thing that's holding me up, and I really don't understand how that's going to work. So we're just going to have to continue to pray about this. 2 weeks later was the first day of the Organic Outreach Conference for that year. And in that intervening 2 weeks, what really got to me was when I stopped and I looked back to that beginning point and I looked at every single thing that God had done in my life. I didn't become a Christian until I was 37 years old. Shortly after that, as a young, immature Christian, I cried out to him. I said, why did you wait 37 years? As I became a more mature Christian, I understood exactly why he waited. There were things he needed me to go through to prepare me for what he had in front of me. From the intervening time between then and when we got down here to Monterey, there were things that he took me through, experiences he took me through, skills he allowed me to help build up. And when I stopped and I looked around at exactly where I was standing at exactly that point in time and what was happening here in Shoreline Church with Organic Outreach International, I got it. He had done everything to prepare me for this. In spite of my zigging and zagging, in spite of everything else, he had brought me to this point for this one purpose, and this is when I realized I have to let go of the last 20 to 25%. I have to trust if this is where he brought me, if this is what he has me to do, he will take care of it. He will fight for me. I need to move on and follow his will. And I've been on staff here for just over a year now, and it has been a much different life for our family, but a much richer life for our family. It's not the future that I had envisioned because I was thinking too shallowly and too shortly. I'm not suggesting that God's will and path for every one of us is to move into full-time ministry, but he does have a plan for you for ministry of some sort in your workplace, in your school, in your family, in your neighborhood. He has somewhere that he's got a plan to use you. Are you listening for his will in your life? We need to be still in our hearts as we actively engage in spiritual battles. This is the essence of faith. Hebrews 11 gives us a laundry list of those who had great faith. Abel, Enoch, Noah, Abraham, Isaac, Jonah, Sarah, Joseph, Moses' parents, Moses, Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, David, Samuel, the list goes on and on and on. And if you look at the stories in the Bible of each one of these, they had their zigs and their zags. But ultimately, they found their path. They found where God had them headed. And they had the faith to trust that he was faithful in his promises to them. In Hebrews 12, we read on, therefore, since we're surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. What battles are you facing right now? What battles are you crying out in your heart? God, why don't you just take this fight for me? Let me sit back and watch. And where in that battle would he have you engage? In Ephesians 6, finally be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against authorities, against the powers of this dark world, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. This verse, this picture of putting on armor, is not one that says, sit back and let God take care of the fight. It's saying, join me in the fight. Join me in the battle. I have won the war, but I want you engaged in the battle. How much more valuable are those things that we work for, that we fight for, that we participate in, that we engage in, than those that are just laid in our lap? How shallow, when taken out of context, is this verse? What picture does this give to people who don't understand Christianity? That it's a God that will just say, I got it. You just ride through the rest of your life. Don't engage. It's so much more exciting to be part of the fight. I encourage you, if you've got verses around on things, know the background, know the foundation, know what underlies those. So when somebody sees that in your office, in your workplace, wherever it is, and asks a question about it, you can say, have a seat. Let me tell you a story. Because this is just scratching the surface. God wants us to follow his plan for us with our free will, willingly and freely following him to the promised land that he has for us. Will you move down that path by his side, with him fighting for you all the way, with you, the full armor of God, fighting alongside? Will you do that? Heavenly Father, I just praise you for the faithfulness to your promises, that you have promised us that you will fight for us, that you have given us the privilege of fighting along your side, that you equip us to do that through the strength of the Holy Spirit, through the discernment that you give us, through the wisdom in your scriptures. Father, would you help us to be humble to the path that you've laid out for us, and to not be groaning and whining about the circumstances, but to ask you, where would you have me fight? Where would you have me go? I want to move on. Father, would you just embed that into our hearts today? Lift us up in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.